Hello students, welcome to the video lecture series of class 12th business studies. Today we are going to continue with the staffing chapter. In our earlier lecture we have already discussed meaning, importance and steps of staffing function. We have also discussed in detail recruitment and what are the various sources of recruitment. The topic covered in this lecture are steps of staffing, training and development, staffing as a part of human resource management, that is HRM. Students, you already know that selection is a process of identifying and choosing the best person out of number of prospective candidates for a job. For example, if there is one post vacant in the organization and 100 people have applied for that job, with selection, we are going to select one out of those 100 prospective candidates. So this is what selection process is. Do you know, students, that selection is considered as a negative process? And why it is called negative process is because selection involves various stages. And at every stage, many candidates are rejected and there are only few people who are able to move to the next stage. And this particular thing continues till the right type of candidate is found. So selection is considered as a negative process, as at every stage there is lot of rejection. The important step in the process of selection are as follows. First, preliminary screening. Second, selection test. Third, employment interview. Fourth, reference and background check. Fifth, selection decision. Sixth, medical examination. Seventh, job offer. And the last one is contract of employment. Now let us discuss these steps in detail. So students, first step is preliminary screening. In this particular stage, manager eliminates unqualified or unfit job seekers based on the information which is supplied in the application form. For example, you may be requiring a person with 4 to 5 year experience, but when you are scrutinizing the application, you saw that people who are fresh graduates or which have no experience, they have applied for the job. So at this particular stage, manager will eliminate those unqualified or unfit job seekers. Second is selection test. It is a mechanism that attempts to measure certain characteristics of an individual's, like aptitude, manual dexterity, intelligence, personality. The various types of tests which are conducted for employees is, first is intelligence test. It is a very important psychological test which checks the IQ of a person, and it indicates the person's learning ability or the ability to make decisions and the judgment in various situations. Second is aptitude test. It measures the person's potential to learn the new skills. It indicates, will the person be able to develop in future or not? Whether the person has a capacity to develop in future? So all this is judged in aptitude test. Third is personality test. This type of test provide a clue to person's emotion, his reaction, maturity, value system. So basically, the overall personality of a person is judged by a test which is called as personality test. The fourth type of test is trait test. The trait test measures the existing skill of an employee, what is the level of knowledge and what is the proficiency of that particular candidate in the area of profession or the technical training. For example, if you want to choose a typist for your organization, you may give him a typing test in which you are going to test his accuracy and the speed in typing. So such type of test is called as trait test. The fifth type of test is called as interest test. Student, you must agree with me that it is very important that employee should be interested in the job for which he has been selected. So this type of test checks what is the interest level or the involvement of a person, whether the person is actually interested in the area in which he has applied or not. So we have done the five types of tests which are covered under test. The third step is employment interview. It is a formal, in-depth conversation between interviewer and the interviewee. and it is conducted to evaluate applicants' suitability for a particular job. Under this, interviewer asks certain questions from interviewee, or sometimes there may not be a one interviewer, there may be a panel or a group of interviewers. So they are going to ask certain questions from the candidate in order to judge whether the candidate is suitable for the job or not. The fourth step is reference and background check. At the time of filling the application form, many employees request name, address, and the telephone number of the references of an applicant. The purpose is to verify the information and gain additional information about the candidate. Previous employers, known persons, teachers, university and university professors can act as a references. Now the fifth step is selection decision. Now management has to make a final decision that out of all the candidates who have passed the test, interview, and whose references have been checked, they have to finally decide out of all these who will be selected in the organization. The sixth step is medical examination. The candidate is required to undergo a medical fitness test, and job offer is given to only those candidates which pass the medical examination. I want to add one thing to this is, sometime this particular step, maybe they are at initial stages. For example, when you are selecting a person for an army or when you are selecting a pilot, medical examination may be there at the initial stages of selection. Seventh point is job offer. Job offer is given to only those applicants who have passed all the previous hurdles, and it is done by giving a letter of appointment to the candidate, and it contains the date of reporting. Seventh point is contract of employment. After the job offer has been made and candidate accepts the offer, employee has to sign a contract of employment, which include terms and conditions of the job, like what are the responsibilities of employee, what are the leave rules, what are the termination rules. So all such terms and conditions are mentioned in this agreement. Employee has to read it carefully and he has to sign this particular document. Now the next topic which we are going to discuss in this lecture is training and development. You already know that it is very important to update the skills of employees by giving them training and to provide employees with the opportunity to grow and take higher positions in future. The basic difference between training and development is, training enables the employee to do the present job better, so it is more job oriented, whereas development enables the overall growth of an employee, so it is more career oriented. For example, if a person is working in the organization and I am making him learn a new software which I am using in my organization, it will come under the category of training. But if I am providing a person with the opportunity to attend workshops on time management, leadership skills, decision making, this all will come under the category of development. Both training and development are beneficial to employees as well as to the organization. Now, what is the benefit of training and development to the employee? It increases the skill and the knowledge of employee, which helps him to earn more, and it also helps him to get a better career in future, and above all, it increases the satisfaction level and the morale of employee. Now, what benefit organization derived out of training and development? If employees are properly trained, there will be less wastage, and the productivity of the organization will increase, the profits will increase, and the absenteeism rate of workers do reduce if they are given proper training. Also, with training and development, we are able to maintain a dynamic workforce which can change according to the changing business environment. You know that business environment is very dynamic. There are changes in technology, changes in the political environment, social environment. So if we have a workforce which is properly trained and developed, they can easily adjust according to the changing environment. The next topic which we are going to discuss is training methods. So there are two training methods. First is on-the-job training, and second is off-the-job training. As it is clear from the name itself, on-the-job training means when the training is given at the same place where the employee is going to perform the job. And what is off-the-job training? It is a type of a training where the training is given away from actual workplace. So we can say that on-the-job training is learning while doing, where off-the-job training is learning before doing. Now let us discuss various training methods. The first training method is apprenticeship program. Under this particular method, the trainee is required to work under a master worker. And this type of training is normally suitable for skilled jobs like plumbers, electricians, or iron workers. The period of this particular training ranges from 3 to 5 years. And this particular training comes under the category of on-the-job training. The second type of training is internship training. Under this type of training, professional institutions send their students to business firms and other organizations to get the practical work experience. For example, the children who are doing medical or engineering, the students who are pursuing chartered accountancy course, they are compulsorily required to work in actual business situation or in actual work environment to gain practical work experience. So they are able to relate the theory which they are learning with the practical part. The third type of training is induction training. This type of training helps an employee to settle down quickly to the new job. Employee is made familiar with the new job environment, fellow employees, machines, and the other things which are there in the organization. And the duration of this particular training may ranges from few hours or to few days. The fourth type of training is vestibule training. Vestibule training come under the category of off-the-job training. In this type of training, the training to employees are given away from actual work floor. But good thing is that actual work environment are created in the classroom, and employees use same material, same file, and same equipment which they are going to actually use at their actual workplace. And this type of training is suitable for the organization which are using sophisticated or a complex machinery. Now let us discuss the last topic of this chapter. Staffing is a part of human resource management, that is HRM. In small organization, managers perform all the duties related to employees' salaries, welfare, and the working conditions. But when the organization grow and the number of people employed increase, a separate department is created, which is called as Human Resource Department. And in this department, there are all specialists who are working, who have a knowledge of managing people. These specialists perform various duties, which are, first, recruitment. This you already know is searching for prospective candidates and stimulating them to apply for the job. Second, analyzing jobs, collecting information about the job and prepare job description. Third, developing the compensation and the incentive plans. Fourth, training and the development of employee. Fifth, maintaining labor relations and union management relations. So whenever there are labor problems which are there in the organization, it is a duty of HRM department to tackle all those problems. Sixth, handling grievances and complaints. If an employee is facing any problem, or if employee has a complaint against an organization, fellow employee, all these grievances and complaints are taken care by HRM department. Seventh, it provides for the social security and the welfare of employees. For example, the insurance schemes, pension schemes, all the retirement benefits, all these things are normally decided by HR department. Eighth is defending a company in a lawsuit and avoiding legal complications. So in case company faces any legal complications related to employee or a labor, this all is taken care by the HR department. So we have seen from these duties that some of the duties performed by the HR managers is same as what we have done in staffing. But not all the duties are covered in staffing. So we can say that staffing is a part of HRM. HRM is a broader concept and staffing is just one part of HRM. So students, we have completed the chapter of staffing. I would like you to go through the chapter thoroughly and understand all the concepts which are covered. I wish you all a happy learning.